أيها الإخوة العرب، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. إنه لفضل عظيم من الله تعالى أن يشرفنا بالجلوس إلى مائدة حضرة أمير المؤمنين ميرزا طاهر أحمد، إمام الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية العالمية، الخليفة الرابع للمسيح الموعود والمهدي المنتظر عليه السلام. ولكن لا بد من القول أنه ما كان لإناء صغير مثلي أن يقدر على استيعاب بحر زاخر بالعلوم والمعارف، ولذلك فإنني أستميحكم العذر عن كل خطأ أو سهو أو نسيان أرتكبه، وأتحمل مسؤولية ذلك على نفسي، وأطمئنكم بأن غياب أخونا الأستاذ حلمي الشافعي إنما هو لخير، لإجازة، وسيعود لكم إليكم وإلينا قريبا إن شاء الله تعالى.
إن شاء الله. نعم خير.
I still remember that in last time we were still talking about how the Ahmadiyya community could
run its affairs.
Yes, financially regarding the Muslim Television Ahmadiyya.
I was telling you how the Ahmadiyya International financial organization gradually grew from a little petal sprouted from the earth, and then it began to grow stronger, stood on its stem, which grew thicker and branched off. So it's a very interesting study. I told you about Tahrik-e-Jadid, how this came into being. The foreign affairs, the movement for the deliverance of message in the foreign countries, as foreign in relation to India. Then, in 1957, at the end of 1957, another movement was launched by the name of Waqf-e-Jadid, the new dedication. This was necessitated by another anti-ahmadiyya movement of 1953-54. You see, the first movement of Tahrik-e-Jadid were necessitated by Majlis-e-Ahrar, those who claimed or boasted that they would demolish Qadian brick by brick. And this was a new anti-ahmadiyya movement which was started in 1953 and fully supported by the then government of Punjab, Daultana's government. So the entire report of that movement and what happened to it is published in the well-known Munir Inquiry Report of the disturbances of the Punjab 1953. But the point I'm making is, every time the enemy attempted to destroy Ahmadiyyat, to counter the effects, a new movement sprang up with the grace of Allah. And the second head of the community in that sense is like an empire builder. All the important permanent institutions in Jama'at Ahmadiyya were introduced by him. And they now make the entire framework of Ahmadiyya community in action in the whole world. So as such, this movement started, and for that a new financial appeal was launched. Every time a movement came into being, another financial appeal was launched. And I happened to be the first member of the administration appointed by the then head of the Ahmadiyya community. And I became immediately involved in the maintenance of the Waqf-e-Jadid, its running, both in the financial section as well as in the other sections. So the Jamaat started paying contributions to this movement with the grace of Allah without raising an eyebrow. You know, they had got so accustomed to and rather addicted to praying in the cause of Allah, that whenever a new movement came, they all came forward and they vied with each other in reaching the office of the Hadhrat Khalifatul Masih sooner than others. So they ran towards the office, sending their letters, promises, etc., some paying things immediately. Women taking their bangles off, golden bangles and things, and sending it to, packing it to Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Sani. So always this beginning of a movement was such an emotional experience, because people from all walks of life, rich and poor, all participated with a zeal which is unseen in the whole world nowadays. So this movement started, and these are the three permanent sources of income of the main organizations of the Jama'at. Sadr Anjuman Ahmadiyya, which deals with the 1/16th regular payment by Ahmadis. Sadr Anjuman Ahmadiyya again, which deals with the 1/10th payment of the entire income and the willing of 1/10th of the property or more. These are the two major sources of income of Sadr Anjuman Ahmadiyya. Tehreek-e-Jadid is run on its own income, and appeal for Tehreek-e-Jadid has become a permanent feature of the Jama'at, which it was started in 1934. So which is the year now? About 61st year has started, and people have not tired, and I'll become 67 come 18th of December. So that means I was a mere child of 6 years when I became a member of this institution. Started paying my chanda ever since, and everybody who started paying, he always increased without fail every year. And when he grew up and had his children, he again repeated the same thing with his children or her children in case of a lady, and made them pay, not forcibly but by persuasion, out of the pocket money which they received. So that is how I trained my children, and they have joined it, but not in the same school. We have four schools or registers. The first register closed after how many years? 13 years?
10 years.
After 10 years. So that meant that all those who had joined this movement till 1944, they were considered as people belonging to the first register, first sigil.
Yes.
And then began the second register, and people started joining it, and that was the new generation of those who offered their sacrifices. And then the register got closed after 10 years or so. Then the third register was open, not exactly 10 years after, and then that got closed, and the fourth register was also opened for the new generation, which has become members of this organization nowadays. So the fourth is in current. After it becomes heavy and fully loaded with the donators, prescribers, then inshallah, I think I or somebody else will have to open a new register. So this is Tehreek-e-Jadid. And as I told you, there are many who still live who belong to the very first register. There would be hundreds, I think. How many hundreds? I don't know. Mm-hmm. Now, these are the major appeals for permanent sacrifice, financial sacrifice, which are maintained with the grace of Allah by the Jama'at. All payments are budgeted. All payments are registered, and receipts are issued against every penny which comes. And this is a universal thing everywhere in the world. Then there are other appeals launched from time to time which are over and above this. But before that, there are three sub-auxiliary organizations or auxiliary auxiliary organizations of the Jama'at which run their separate institutions and collect their money to run the organization separately over and above this. This is the whole system of the Jama'at, you know. It has grown into a very powerful machinery with the grace of Allah. So this system is divides Ahmadis into three major groups. One, Ansarullah. Ansarullah are the group which are above the age of 40 till death. So that is one group. And all those who join Ansarullah, of course, they run their own separate organization within the Jama'at without any clash with the main Jama'ati institutions at all. Because this is one thing which is not tolerated in the Jama'at. Ta'awun wal birr wa taqwa is the main principle. So wherever an organization is seen to cause a friction, immediately that organization is dissolved, and until people repent and request from the depth of their hearts that will not repeat the mistake, the organization is dissolved. We don't want any friction or bad blood flowing into the Jama'at. So, and this is being washed right from the top. Each president of the organization of every country is the name of such proposed presidents for the whole country are always approved by me, have always been approved by the Khalifa of the time. And a very strict eye is kept on the type and the quality, and also how such name was proposed. If there is any, even the slightest element of doubt of people joining hands, ganging up, or making lobbies, such election is nullified. And then either new election, healthy and fair election is held, or somebody is appointed who has been a very tried servant of Ahmadiyya with complete commitment and loyalty to the cause. So exactly on the same pattern is the second organization, which has its membership from the age of 15 to the age of 40. So that is the second major organization, very active all over the world. In England they have their own Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya. We call it Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya. In Germany they have their own Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya. In Holland they have their own. In all African countries, in Far Eastern countries, wherever there is Jama'at, it's always subdivided into these three sections. First two, Ansarullah, Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya, and the third is Lajna. Lajna Imaillah. This covers the age from 15 till death. And no division is made between young Lajna and the old Lajna. And this is a tribute to the intelligence of our Khalifa who devised the system. Because he knew the human nature and he knew the women are very reluctant to show their ages. So if an age is drawn, you know, after youth, they would be very loath to declare that. So maybe some are driven to telling lies, you know. So in the name of goodness, we'll be teaching badness. Bad things. That is why there is no age division. Right from the time of 15 till death, all are young Lajna. Right? And they have their own separate system of financing. And each has its own additional appeals. If Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya undertakes to build a central office and a central place where Khuddam from the whole country can come, get together and participate in activities like sports and things, they are not given anything from Jama'at fund. They have to make an appeal separately, and only Khuddam participate in that. People belong to the organization. Then Lajna does the same. Whenever they need a hall or a wagon or something for the work of preaching, etc., they have to stand on their own feet and they have to collect money by themselves. And sometimes they do it by spending their time in additional professions which are not their profession, but apart from their normal course of life, they start sewing and tailoring and sell the things to the market just for the purpose of collecting some additional money for the good cause. So these appeals are numberless in Khuddam ul Ahmadiyya, in Lajna Ma'illa, in Ansar.
How can I talk about numberless appeals?
By telling them that they are numberless. But a few more words. Then there are appeals for special purposes by the Jama'at as such, not Khuddam, Lajna separately, but by the Jama'at. And that appeal is always launched by the Khalifa himself. When I arrived here in London, this place was so small. We needed so much additional structure and open space because it was impossible for the Jama'at activities of the whole world to be centered in London and jam-packed into this small place. So we had to buy an open space somewhere where we were given rights to work as a spiritual religious community. So we bought a place in Islamabad, which we named it Islamabad, is in Tilford, in Surrey, around 39 miles from this place, where we had an open area of 25 acres plus. Altogether is 26 some, I think. And later on we bought some more. And we were so lucky to get that place. It's amazing. First of all, when I launched an appeal, immediately the whole world of Ahmadiyyat participated so generously. Particularly the ladies created new records of sacrifices. Almost all the members of the Jama'at, ladies, were emptied of their, you know, their adornments and their pieces of jewelry and diamonds or gold or whatever they had, completely. Some were completely left without anything except for their marriage ring, for instance. That was the only thing left there. And if I said no, they would start crying. They said, no, for God's sake, no. It happened here in London so many times. It was very difficult for me to suppress my emotions in their presence, because if they cried and I started, then God knows what would happen to me in those days. So I had to become very stiff inside, outwardly, you know. Inside I was absolutely molten. So this is how it started, and with the grace of Allah we got it. And now our annual function is held in that place. It was so fortunate that people didn't realize what we were buying it for. We bought it for the same educational purposes, otherwise it would not be given to us. And fortunately, the definition of education in England is so vast that all the religious activities are covered by the word education. So when they knew what we were and what we came for and the religious activity and day and night during the Jalsa, it was crowded by people. The people around us so conservative that they didn't like it. They raised their brows. What is happening here? So they even served us notices, wanted to drag us to the court, etc., that you must finish all these activities. This is not a place for running a religious organization. It is a place for education. So with the grace of Allah, we had the whole law of act on education brought out. And I personally studied it, and I was amazed to find this beautiful, you know, clause in that. Education is not just conventional education, it's also religious education, instructions of all sorts. It can be given to the whole world from there. So that's what we're doing. So these friends, I'm just talking of financial system. Then I made appeals for European mosques. And then I made appeals for different mosques here and different mosques in Germany. I made appeal for 100 mosques in Germany and for Holland, for Belgium, for this, for that, for Africa. Hundreds of mosques are added every year, not from the main funds, but in response to the appeals, specifically launched for these purposes. This is the community. How can we be slaves to anybody in the world? If anybody is free financially, if he does not have to extend his hand, begging hands or bowl to anybody else, then there is no need for any ties with anything. And that is why the only religious community which is absolutely free in the whole world is Jama'at Ahmadiyya. With the grace of Allah. I hope, inshallah.
In fact, this kind of subject in itself, mm-hmm. I don't know anything about it.
Really?
Yeah. All I have to say is from my memory of what I heard of you. I only knew just few things about this.
Exactly.
Yes, but inshallah I can. تابع حضرة أمير المؤمنين في إجابته على السؤال المتعلق بتمويل الجماعة لهذا المشروع الضخم العملاق مشروع المحطة الفضائية للـ MTA التلفزيون الإسلامي الأحمدي العالمي وكي يبين بالتفصيل الدقيق كما تعودنا عليه دائما أن يكمل أي موضوع حقه فيعطي المعرفة تامة غير منقوصة تابع بشرح النشاطات والتنظيمات في الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية بترتيباتها ومؤسساتها الرئيسية والفرعية التي كانت تتأسس للاستجابة للمتطلبات المالية في كل حال تنشأ وتطلب من جديد شيئا من التمويل وقال حضرته في بيان جميل بأن الجماعة بعون الله تعالى قد وجدت بأنه كلما كان هناك تحد يعاكس ويضاد الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية سواء من خصومها أو سواء تحدي يتطلب قدرات ويتطلب استطاعات وتمويل كانت تنشأ في الجماعة منظمات مقابلة أو تنظيمات مقابلة تفي بالغرض للوقوف في وجه هذه التحديات وفي تأمين ما يلزم للجماعة وأعطى بعض التفصيل عن ذلك ذكر أول ما ذكر التحريك الجديد الذي على ما أذكر تم تأسيسه عام 1957 الوقف الجديد
التحريك الجديد فرست تحريك الجديد
اولا التحريك الجديد
في
1934 في عام 1934 ثم الوقف الجديد في عام 1957 قام هذا التحريك في مواجهة حركة ضد الأحمدية كانت في عام 1953 أو عام 1954 وكما قلنا بأنه كلما حاول خصوم الأحمدية عمل شيء لينالوا من قوة الجماعة كانت تظهر في الجماعة تنظيمات جديدة تقوم داعمة لها وتقويها وتؤسس بناءها كالذي يبني إمبراطورية واسعة تتنامى شيئا فشيئا وتتوسع شيئا فشيئا إلى أن تغطي العالم جميعا في التحريك الجديد يذكر أمير المؤمنين بأن عمره كان في ذلك الوقت 6 سنوات وكان من أول المشاركين كعضو من أول المؤسسين في هذا الموضوع. ويقول بأن أفراد الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية كانوا في كل مكان يسارعون للتبرعات وتقديم البذل من أموالهم بكل سهولة ويسر وحب وحماس ودون أدنى تردد. وكذلك كنا النساء الأحمديات التي كنا يسارعنا دائما إلى تقديم العون، كيف لا وهن شقائق الرجال، لا يتأخرن عن الرجال الأحمديين خطوة، بل يسير معهم في خدمة هذا الدين العظيم وفي خدمة هذه الجماعة حبا من القلب وقناعة في العقل ومنطلقا من الوجدان، يبذلون أموالهم رخيصة وهم أيضا مستعدون لبذل كل شيء حتى نفسهم. إذن كانت هناك أضيفة إلى المصدرين الأوليين للتمويل، الأول الذي هو من صدر أنجم صدر أنجما، والذي التبرع فيه يتبرع فيه كل فرد أحمدي بنسبة 1 على 16 من ماله. ثم التنظيم الآخر وهو تنظيم نظام الوصية الذي يتبرع فيه الأحمدي بنسبة 1 على 10 من دخله أثناء حياته، أو يوصي بنفس ويوصي أيضا
أو يزيدون فيه
أو يزيدون بهذه النسبة إلى حد الثلث. سمعت مرة قد تصل
one third
الثلث. نعم. وكذلك يوصي بعد وفاته بنفس النسبة. ثم ذكرت شيئا هناك عن تحريك الجديد بشكل دائم الذي تأسس عام 1943، وإلى الآن عمر هذا التحريك 61 سنة، ولا زال هناك من الأحمديين من لا زال هناك حيا ممن كان في عند تأسيس هذا التحريك. وكان الأحمديون دائما يدفعون أهلهم وأولادهم وأطفالهم للمشاركة بهذا البذل لكي يعتادوا. طبعا لا يكون ذلك بالإكراه، الإكراه لا تعرفه الجماعة أبدا ولا في أي ميدان من الميادين، لأن الأساس الذي تقوم عليه هو أنه لا إكراه في الدين. فإذا كان الإكراه لا يجوز في الدين، فمن باب أولى أنه لا يجوز في أي شيء آخر أبدا. لذلك ليس من إكراه في الجماعة ولا في أي موقف من مواقفها، وإنما الأحمديون من أنفسهم يبذلون ذلك حبا وقناعة وإيمانا وعن رضا نفس، حتى أن البعض لو إذا لم يتمكن من البذل أو رفض بذله لشيء لسبب من الأسباب يشعر بالحزن والاستياء. وكانت النساء تبكي إذا رفض منهن المساعدة عندما يعلن أمير المؤمنين نصره الله قبول تبرعات لمشاريع معينة مثل بناء المساجد. مثلا أمير المؤمنين عندما جاء إلى لندن كان المكان صغيرا وعاديا وغير قادرا على استيعاب كافة النشاطات، لذلك كان لابد من أن يعلن أن على الأحمديين أن يبذلوا من أموالهم لكي يوسعوا هذا المكان ولكي يؤسسوا مكانا يمكن أن يستوعب جميع النشاطات الثقافية والعلمية والدينية. فطلب أمير المؤمنين من الأحمديين في العالم أن يتبرعوا، فانهالت التبرعات من جميع أنحاء العالم للمساعدة في هذا الأمر، وتم شراء قطعة أرض تبعد عن لندن حوالي 39 ميل، وكانت قطعة هذه الأرض بمساحة 26 إيكرز. نعم. فدان. نعم. وتم تسمية هذه المنطقة باسم إسلام أباد، وتمت الموافقة على بيعها للمسلمين الأحمديين لأنها كانت تعتبر أرضا تقدم للنشاطات الثقافية، وحسب القانون الإنجليزي فإن المادة التي توافق على بيع الأراضي والعقار للنشاطات الثقافية تكاد تتسع لكل أنواع النشاطات الثقافية العلمية والدينية وفي كل شيء. وبذلك استفاد الأحمديون من هذه المادة واستطاعوا أن يشتروا هذه الأرض، ولكن عندما تم إبراز أهم النشاطات الثقافية مثل الجلسة السنوية التي يجتمع فيها الآلاف أو عشرات الألوف من كافة أنحاء العالم، كان المنظر مذهلا للغاية للجميع، ولم يكونوا يتخيلوا بأن النشاط الثقافي يمكن أن يأخذ هذا الشكل وهذا الحجم الهائل من القلوب التي تهوي مؤمنة إلى أن تنهل من فيض المعرفة والنور والتعارف للمسلمين فيما بين بعضهم البعض. وتحدث مولانا أمير المؤمنين عن اللجان التي تدعم نشاطات الجماعة، فذكر أنصار الله الذين هم في أعمار ما فوق 40 عاما وإلى آخر العمر، وهؤلاء أيضا يديرون تنظيمات معينة لا تتضارب فيما بينها وبين غيرها من التنظيمات، لأن المبدأ الذي يقومون عليه هو مبدأ وتعاونوا على البر والتقوى ولا تعاونوا على الإثم والعدوان، ولو حدث أي خطأ من أي تنظيم أو أي فرد فإنه يبعد ولا يقبل إلى أن يتوب ويلتمس العفو، وعند ذلك يمكن أن يسمح له بالعودة لمتابعة نشاطه. أما التنظيم الآخر فهو خدام الأحمدية، وأعمار المنتسبين إليه يقع ما بين 15 من العمر و40 من العمر، وهم كذلك في كل أنحاء العالم. والتنظيم الثالث هو لجنة إماء الله، وينتمي إليه البنات والنساء من الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية ما فوق سن 15 سنة إلى آخر العمر. ويقول مولانا أمير المؤمنين بأن في ذلك كان ذكاء لماع من حضرة الخليفة الثاني على ما أذكر الذي أسس هذا، لأنه في عدم تحديد عمر فوق 15 نعفي النساء من ذكر أعمارهن في مراحل فيما لو قسمت، ولأن النساء يحببن أن يخفين أعمارهن فقد وافقهن على ذلك وأعفاهن من هذا. على كل حال النساء الأحمديات كنا دائما يبدين نفس الحماس ونفس البذل مما يطلب إليهم من قبل الجماعة. يقول أمير المؤمنين بأنه عندما طلب من الأحمديين في العالم المشاركة لشراء قطعة الأرض الكبيرة هذه في إسلام أباد، النساء الأحمديات قدمنا جميع حليهن، حتى أن الكثيرات منهن لم يتركن شيئا لأنفسهن على الإطلاق سوى خاتم الخطبة. وعندما كان يحاول أمير المؤمنين أن يقنعهن بأن يتركن لأنفسهن شيئا أو أن يعدلن عن ذلك، كنا يبكين ويرجون ألا يرفض طلبهن، وكان هذا يؤثر كثيرا في مولانا أمير المؤمنين ويزيده قوة وعزما بعون الله على الوقوف قائدا لهذه الجماعة في كافة أنحاء العالم للبناء والتقوي والتوسع. لذلك أعلن الدعوة لإعمار 100 من المساجد، مثلا أعلن الدعوة لإعمار 100 مسجد في أوروبا،
في ألمانيا
فقط. نعم، 100 مسجد في ألمانيا، وكذلك مساجد لأفريقيا، وهذه 100 من المساجد تعمر في كل عام. ألف أو أكثر.
Yes, in the whole world.
نعم.
New mosques are built at the rate of more than 1,000. mostly in Africa.
نعم في كل عام تبني الجماعة ما يعادل ألف مسجد أو أكثر بعون الله تعالى. يقول مولانا أمير المؤمنين بأن هذا لا يستغرب على جماعة حرة ماليا ليست معتمدة على أي مصدر مادي غير نفسها وأبنائها بعون الله تعالى. لذلك هي تبذل من القلب ومن الوجدان عن رضا وطيب نفس ويسعدها هذا التقديم، ولذلك هي حرة وتعمل ما لا تستطيع قوة أخرى في الأرض أن تعمله، لأن القدرة الحرة المتوجهة إلى الله طالبة رضا الله يكون الله في عونها وتعطي الكثير الكثير. I hope I can do it.
Now let me first of all clarify a point of, that relates to the name of this center, Islamabad. Some people think that out of jealousy of Islamabad in Pakistan, we have misappropriated the name and we had no right, but so intention is not good. Just to tease those who made us leave the country, we have named this center as Islamabad. This is not true. We are not mean people. We don't think in small terms. The world does not know that the first Islamabad that was ever created in Europe was this place. Still, its telegraphic address is Islamabad, London. You can write thus this name, Islamabad, London, and the telegram will reach here, dot on the place. So this was done in 1924. And this Islam was built after the partition only, you know, some years after the partition of Pakistan and India. So I'm just clarifying the position. Some people propagate that, look here, these are the people out of jealousy for the government of, we have no jealousy with the government of Pakistan. We are Pakistani citizens. We love Pakistan. But only what the bad things, when the bad things are committed and crimes are perpetrated against us, and we protest, naturally this is the right of every Muslim to do make the protest. And as far as the mosques, the numbers of mosques and the spread of the mission houses after my departure from Pakistan is concerned, let me remind you of one phenomenon. People say, where the money comes from? The true answer is, it comes from Allah. We don't know how it comes. Every time they want to suppress us, our enemies, and make us smaller, tighten us into a smaller place, Allah opens it up and gives us far more than what they have taken away. In the entire anti-ahmadiyya movement in Pakistan recently, about 11 mosques were either burned down or demolished, and some were closed. So a number you can count on your fingers. But the mosques God has given us since that time is are practically numberless. There may be a few thousand, but they're growing constantly, so you can't count them. And in Europe alone, the centers which God provided us after my arrival here, in space, in quality, in every respect, are around 100 times greater and more spacious than all the centers we had prior to my coming here. So they try to squeeze Ahmadiyyat into smaller places. Allah keeps his promise that you do hijrah in my name and I'm going to expand. And we are a living example. So I don't have to tell you exactly where it comes from. It does not come from any ungodly source. This is 100% certain. The money doesn't come from governments, doesn't come from enemies of Islam or even non-Ahmadi Muslims. If they participate in a good cause, in a very small degree and small extent, I always show the large-heartedness. I say, all right, it's a good cause, you can join us. But it is not even 1/10,000th or 1,000,000th of what we are spending in the name of Allah. I think most certainly it is not even 1,000,000th that is maybe also a bit liberal estimate. Very seldom, sometimes, some good man would say, all right, I have come, I've seen this work, take 1,000 rupees or 10 pounds. So even 1 million is an exaggeration. The rest is all given by the Jama'at Ahmadiyya, and Allah opens up the hearts, Allah increases the capacity for them to pay, and this is how the Ahmadiyya organization is being run with the grace of Allah all over the world. So those who join us, they should remember this. They should not be mistaken by the propaganda and believe that they are joining a community which will pay them something. The mullahs are propagating that this Jama'at is a very rich Jama'at which gets money from other sources, and whoever joins Ahmadiyyat, they pay them something. So if you join Ahmadiyyat with this intention, you're in for a big shock. Very big shock. We'll empty your pockets in the name of Allah and then ask you to join us and be beaten up. And be dishonored in your own country and by your own people. This is the price of Ahmadiyyat you have to pay, we don't. Because this is the price of Islam which the early Muslim paid and offered the feet of the Holy Master Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is Ahmadiyyat, nothing else.
If you would allow me just comment on the last point. In Hosh Arab, where Ahmadiyya began to spread there, one of the rumors said that I used to take 80,000 sterling pound per head. this is what they said.
That's right. You see, this is how they specialize in telling lies. They appropriate lies now. No one in the world speaks so many lies as the mullahs, the custodians of Islamic values. Imagine. Such utter lies that you cannot imagine, you cannot dream. Nowadays, they are spreading the propaganda in Pakistan, particularly in Karachi, that all the cruelties done to the muhajireen, the immigrants from India in Karachi, are being done by Ahmadis. The police officers are Ahmadi, every administration is Ahmadi, while there's not a single police officer with Ahmadiyya cross. And they know it. The MQM people know it. And yet aid the propaganda to be on the right side of the mullahs. They go on concocting things. Nobody checks them. Nobody slaps them on the face. That you are speaking from the pulpit of Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Shame on you for such lies. Nobody. They take pride in making more lies. We are targeted for lies by these people. And this is exactly an example of Shusharab. Yes. Everywhere it's the same.
To the extent that a big officer said, if that is true, and Ahmadis do really do that, we are ready to make all the Syrian army to join them so that we can be at the...
Well said. Well said.
يتابع مولانا أمير المؤمنين نصره الله فيقول بأن البعض يشيعون بأن تسمية تلك الأرض التي تم شراؤها في قريبا من لندن باسم إسلام أباد إنما تم من قبل الأحمديين لإغاظة الباكستانيين هناك في الباكستان ويقول نحن لا نفكر بهذا الشكل أبدا إن أول اسم إسلام أباد سمي في أوروبا هو كان اسم هذه المنطقة التي نحن فيها ويكفي في البريد أن تكتب لندن إسلام أباد فتصل الرسالة إلى المكان بالضبط
telegraphic address.
في البرقية في البرق أن ترسل برقية فتصل مباشرة لندن إسلام أباد
telegraphic address in Europe in the name of Islamabad is this place.
وكان أول اسم عنوان إسلامي في أوروبا برقي هو هذا المكان اسم إسلام أبا يقول مولانا أمير المؤمنين نحن في النهاية مواطنون باكستانيون ونحب وطننا ولا يمكن أن نفكر بأسلوب الإغاظة أو الإزعاج أو التقليد هذا ليس من أخلاقنا ولا وليس من عاداتنا. ثم يتابع فيقول بعد وصولي إلى هنا عدد المساجد والمراكز التبشيرية الذي تم إنشاؤه وبناؤه كان كثيرا جدا. وأما عن المال الذي يأتي ففي الواقع نحن لا ندري إلا أن الله سبحانه وتعالى هو الذي كان ييسر لنا ونجد أننا قادرين بفضل الله عز وجل على القيام بالمشاريع اللازمة لخدمة ديننا. كانوا كلما ضيقوا علينا الخناق وضيقوا علينا السبل كلما أوسع الله علينا أكثر وأكثر. مثلا في الباكستان قاموا بإحراق بتخريب وإحراق 11 مسجدا أحمديا. ماذا كانت النتيجة؟ كانت النتيجة أن الله أعاننا على بناء مئات وآلاف المساجد خارج الباكستان، وهذا عطاء يفوق بكثير أي قدرة على التخيل، بأنه مقابل عدد ضئيل من المساجد التي كانوا يخربوها بأيديهم ويحرقونها، أعطانا الله مساجد أكثر وانتشارا أكثر وأوسع في البلاد والعباد. وكان الله كان يقول لنا هاجروا أنتم باسمي لنشر دينكم ودعوتكم وسأوسع أنا عليكم الطرق والسبل. لا يأتينا مال من أي مصدر غير أحمدي، لا من حكومات ولا من مؤسسات ولا من منظمات ولا من أحد آخر من العالم. وأستطيع أن أؤكد بأنه لا يأتينا ولا حتى واحد بالمليون من المال مساعدة من أي طرف آخر. ربما لو فكر البعض بأن يقدموا شيئا ما، قد ربما يفكر الإنسانيون.
نعم، بعض المسلمين والنون أحمديين وغير الأحمديين، they sometimes insist. They say we want to give this much small amount to this mosque or to that school or that hospital. So I accept it just for the sake of pleasing them, not for the sake of any requirement. That doesn't make any difference to our finances.
يقول إن بعض الناس يتحمس من المسلمين يتحمسون ويتعاطفون للتعاون من أجل بناء مدرسة أو مسجد، ويقولون رجاء اقبلوا منا هذا القليل من المال. يقول أمير المؤمنين نحن لسنا بحاجة أحد، ولكن ما كان يسعني إلا أن أقبل منهم وذلك لكي أسعدهم هم وأرضيهم هم، ليس لأننا بحاجة إليهم. ولكن مع ذلك يظل التأكيد بأنه ولا واحد بالمليون، وحتى الواحد بالمليون يمكن أن يعتبر مبالغة في حد ذاته، ولا واحد بالمليون يأتينا من غير الأحمديين. لذلك يوجه أمير المؤمنين نصره الله تنبيها غاية في الأهمية إلى جميع الذين يفكرون بالانضمام إلى هذه الجماعة. يقول انتبهوا، إن هذه الجماعة يشاع عنها أنها جماعة غنية وأنها تقدم المال لمن ينضم إليها، هذا ما يشيعه المشايخ. ولكني أقول لكم انتبهوا، فإننا لا نعطي أحدا قرشا واحدا، بل العكس، إن أفراد الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية هم الذين يقدمون من مالهم إذا انضموا إلى الجماعة، وهم الذين يبذلون من أنفسهم، وهم الذين يبيعون لله عز وجل. ويقول أمير المؤمنين نصره الله وهل من المعقول أن هؤلاء المشايخ ينتظرون منا أنهم بعد أن يضطهدون ويضربون وأيضا يريدون أن يدخلوا في جماعتنا وأن نفرغ لهم جيوبنا وأن نعطيهم أموالنا؟ هذا كلام ليس معقول ولا منطقي. وذكرت لمولانا أمير المؤمنين أمرا واقعيا خبرته بنفسي عندما كنت أتحدث بالفكر الإسلامي الأحمدي في إحدى قرى بلاد الشام في سوريا قرية حوش عرب كان سمعت بأن المشايخ هناك كانوا يشيعون يقولون اسمعوا أتعلمون إن منير إدلبي يعطي يأخذ على كل رأس من الناس المنضمين له 80,000 جنيه استرليني وهذا المبلغ طبعا يعتبر مبلغا خياليا عندما نقل هذا الكلام إلى بعض الضباط في تقاريرهم السرية ضحك مليا وقال إذا كان الأمر كذلك فأنا على استعداد لأن أتوسط لأن أجعل الجيش السوري بأكمله ينضم إليكم ونأخذ على كل فرد 80,000 جنيه استرليني وسنغدو أغنى دولة في العالم كل هذه الإشاعات إشاعات مغرضة ومرفوضة وكاذبة ويقول أمير المؤمنين عار عليكم وأنتم تدعون الإسلام وتدعون أنكم تنتسبون إلى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم أن تحاولوا نصر معتقدكم بالأكاذيب والاختلاقات والإشاعات الكاذبة.
And also I said don't be mistaken and deceived by this propaganda or you're in for a big shock. Instead of paying you anything,
yes.
we're going to get all these chandas from you if you join Ahmadiyya. You see?
No.
So be ready for this.
No. يقول أيضا بأن عليكم أن تنتبهوا وأن لا تنخدعوا بهذه الإشاعات فإذا ما انضممتم إلى الأحمدية فإن كل هذه الأموال سوف تخرج من جيوبكم أنتم
yes.
وأنتم الذين سوف تغرمون بذلك ولن تحصلوا على شيء
and
من
others will also rob you out of you know by way of punishing you for what you have become
وأيضا سوف تتعرضون لأن تخسروا مالا ليس في إعطاء الجماعة والمساهمة ولكن ربما تتعرضون لأن يسطو عليكم الآخرون من أعداء الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية وأن يسرقوا أموالكم ويسطو عليها مثل ما حدث في الباكستان وفي المناطق المتعصبة من العالم.
And that is exactly what happened in the early times of Islam. They had to offer their money. They were not offered any money by Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the gateway to the entry of Islam was إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةَ What we have done is we have lifted the same gateway and installed again for the time of آخرين.
نعم. يقول مولانا أمير المؤمنين إذا نظرنا إلى التاريخ نجد أن الحدث المماثل كان في صدر الإسلام. كان هذا تماما ما يحدث في أول الإسلام. كانت أموال المسلمين هي التي تصادر وأذكر أن أحد الصحابة ربما كان هو صهيب الذي اضطر إلى ترك ماله في المدينة حتى قال له رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ربح البيع صهيب ربح البيع ويقول مولانا أمير المؤمنين بأن البوابة الكبيرة للدخول إلى الإسلام هي قول الله عز وجل إن الله اشترى من المؤمنين أنفسهم وأموالهم بأن لهم الجنة.
This was the same gate then, which is reinstalled now by Ahmadiyya Jamaat. You have forgotten to tell this.
نعم. وهي الآن نفس البوابة التي تؤسس وتعمر وتبنى والتي تقيمها الجماعة ويدخل منها الأحمديون في جميع أركان الأرض.
Now the one last thing I must tell you that this is all this is not sufficient. To support the works which we undertaken in the name of Islam and for the sake of Islam. The task is immense. But how can we do it? How can we perform it with the little money? The answer is bi'anfusikum, lies in the word bi'anfusikum. We do not make only financial sacrifices, but we also offer our lives. For the service of Islam. And there are thousands and thousands of Ahmadi youth who did it despite the fact that they were educated at their own expense. They could get any government or other jobs in the world, high paid job in the world. They did not care a hoot for that. They offered their lives for the sake of Islam and they were told there is no commitment. if Jama'at could pay, it would. If not, you have to shift by yourself. Ask your parents. But they all did it happily and with open hearts. And the payment, this rate of payment was so small that one is amazed at how they could continue to live a respectable white-collar life. But what happened was, mostly those who offered their lives, their parents or the others helped them a little bit from their private incomes. Otherwise, the Jama'at at that time could not afford to pay much. I was one of those who dedicated my lives in early days, because my father had willed that I want all my children to dedicate their lives for the sake of Islam. So luckily, I was not only one of those who did, but I was also chosen for this actual service in 1957, when I had finished my studies in Lahore, in England, and returned home to Pakistan. Then I was called. All right, you have finished your studies, come and report. And I was appointed in Waqf-e-Jadid, as I've already told you. Can you imagine how much, what was my initial pay? I was the boss of the whole institution. What would be my pay in those days, in 1957? £1 sterling and a quarter per month. Or half a pound maybe, because it was exactly 80 rupees to begin with. 80 Pakistani rupees now are a pound and a half. At that time, they were £5 a month. And my peon, the lowest paid in Waqf-e-Jadid, received 60 rupees as against 80 of mine. Later on, installments were bigger, rises were bigger in case of higher officers, smaller in case of small workers, but the beginning point was so close. And the maximum difference between the highest paid and the lowest paid was less than one third, 1 to 3. So this is how we work. Thousands of people have left the world alone and offered their services, and there are many thousands, many, many thousands in fact, who have not offered their lives permanently, but they are practically the servants of Ahmadiyya without any cost. Now, coming to this MTA, the major expenses is not how to lift the programs and broadcast them to the rest of the world or to televise them. Always the major expenses are incurred in preparing the programs, running the institutions, and all this work is done free of cost by Jama'at Ahmadiyya. All the boys and men who are running this MTA, the whole world MTA, do it without getting a single penny. Their students, their other workers, their employees, and their women, their children, their old boys, old men and young men, they all do it for the sake of gaining Allah's favors. They're not paid a penny. So even though we receive so much money from volunteer, from the mu'mineen who want to pay for the cause of Allah, the work is so big, it could not have been sufficient, that money. But this is how we are maintaining. This boy, come here, please. You keep him standing every time, you know, till late at night. Come here. Here, come here, in front. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah. Kya naam hai aapka?
Adil.
What do you do?
I've just finished studying.
Still finished studies. You have been a student?
Yes, I have.
And how could you come here sacrificing your studies, etc.? I've been seeing you for so many months or years. Eh? How could you do it?
I don't know.
You don't know, but you do it.
I do it.
Do you get any money in exchange?
No.
Not a penny? Right. Jazakumullah. Come here, please. The second cameraman. And the rest of the organization is sitting either there or in the van or in here or there. They're all just, tell me about yourself. What's your name?
Akhil.
Akhil. What do you do? You work?
I work.
Yeah. You're on your own?
Yeah.
At some place, you know?
Yeah.
You're employed?
Yeah.
And how can you afford to come here every day? I see you every day, every evening, you are here. Are you paid for it?
No.
No, nothing?
No.
Not a penny?
No.
Do you come at your own expense?
Yes.
Huh? They come here at their own expense, they go back at their own expense, they eat their own food, they work or they study or they do anything else. But here they come with such dedication. It's unbelievable. If this miracle can be repeated by any other Jama'at in Islam, come forward, do it, show it to the world. This is the sign of truth.
Jazakumullah. يتابع أمير حضرة أمير المؤمنين فيقول إن كل ومع ذلك فإن كل هذا البذل والعطاء من أفراد الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية في العالم وحده لا يكفي لإنجاز الأعمال والإنجازات الضخمة الهائلة التي تكاد تقام في كل دولة ومدينة في الأرض لذلك لابد كان لابد من عطاء آخر ودعم آخر وهي الفقرة التي تتعلق بقول الله تعالى وأنفسكم أنفسهم فالمسلمون الأحمديون لا يقدمون فقط المال ويبذلونه لنشر دين الله والانتصار له وإنما أيضا يقدمون أنفسهم للخدمات المجانية التي لا يقبضون من ورائها شيئا على الإطلاق رغم افتقارهم في كثير من الأحيان للعمل ورغم افتقارهم للمال الآلاف المؤلفة يقدمون أنفسهم لإنجاز ما يطلب إليهم من أعمال وما يلزم من عمل وهم لا يكونون من الذين قد كرسوا أنفسهم للجماعة ولكن لهم أيضا أعمالهم التي يقومون بها ولكن الناظر إليهم يجد أنهم من الناحية العملية يعملون مع الجماعة وكأنهم قد كرسوا أنفسهم لتقديم جميع الخدمات مجانا دون أن يأخذوا ولا حتى بنسا واحدا لا يستطيع المرء أن يصدق كيف هؤلاء يقدمون كل هذا البذل بسعادة وحب ورضا في سبيل الله عز وجل رغم أن البعض إذا كان يخدم بشيء من الأجر فلا يكاد الأجر يكفيه شيئا على الإطلاق كنت من الذين اختاروا وكرسوا أنفسهم للإسلام في عند إحداث الوقف الجديد التحريك الجديد
I was a child when I did it, but I was accepted after I grew up into adult age. But my services were called when I finished my studies. Everything my father wanted to teach me, I did and finished. Then I reported to the Jama'at in 1957.
That was...
The year of Waqf-e-Jadid. So I was appointed there.
Al-Waqf-e-Jadid.
That's right.
في البداية
But shouldn't we do it tomorrow inshallah? Because time is already over and we'll take up from here and continue.
Inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum.